of plants alongside around the same number of paintings of birds and animals amount to one of the most extensive collections of flora and fauna produced by a company official on the subcontinent in the 18th century. This type of drawing points to the systematic depiction of plants in the European conventions of Linnaean taxonomy on plain sheets of paper, the sheer number of works, and the moments of startling artistry in many of the depictions. But they can also be with other paintings and other art forms, including poetry, gardens, and recipes, to expand the approach to the depiction of plants and birds in which works made for company officials are one part. For instance, Martin's inscribed painting of a flaming lily can be related to one included in an album of 17th and 18th century Indian paintings that Francis Deuce collected in the early 19th century, or to paintings of flowers placed adjacent to gardens in another one of his albums. Here, the singular flower is attended to alongside its position within the garden, its laborers and users, as well as its metaphors. It opens up the question of ephemeral arts and their documentation in other ones, and specifically within that, the connections between food and art, which I'll discuss today via flowering plants, fruits and vegetables, and other produce like legumes. Martin's Flaming Lily looks different when considered as one among the 600 in the series, and different still when connected to other arts in the region. So together, they offer an opportunity to think through a range of approaches to the depiction of cultivation and sale, from a single painting to the series as a data set, to farms and gardens, gardeners and grain sellers, markets and albums, to consider how ephemeral arts pass down to us through representation. Born in Lyon in 1735, Claude Martin traveled to India in 1751 at the age of 16 in the army of the French East India Company. However, as the British gained power, he switched to the company's forces in 1760. And in 1775, he became superintendent of the Nawab or Mughal governor of Awadh's arsenal in Lucknow. And in 1779, he became an employee of the Nawab himself and remained in the region until his death in 1800. As Rosie Llewellyn-Jones has spiritedly documented, Martin was an extraordinary man with a keen sense for business alongside a range of eclectic interests, from hot air balloon flights to rerouting a river to cool a house of his own design. In 1786, he took over the estate of Najafgarh, which can be viewed in this watercolor by Sita Ram, made a few decades later, and became a local landowner. While he continued to grow and sell crops for the local market, he also introduced potentially lucrative, high-value raw materials, like indigo for dyes and roses for fragrant waters and perfumes. He also experimented with potentially valuable produce like the potato and tobacco. He further hired Indian artists, whose names remain unknown to us, to primarily depict plants and birds, which amount to around, again, 600, including this one of coriander. The artists were taught to focus on parts of the plants important to Linnaean taxonomy, and most of the plants bear Linnaean names to the extent possible within that system. Some are also inscribed with the names of the plants in Persian and Urdu. While scholars have focused on the qualities and products of Martin that were exceptional, here I'd like to turn to Martin's 600 paintings as a data set and acknowledge the work of Henry Nolte in cataloging this collection at Kew Gardens and his generosity in sharing the materials with me. Looking at the set of paintings as a whole, it becomes clear that while Martin did experiment with certain lucrative items, he also maintained the crops already in rotation that supplied a local market as well as his own pantry. We see coriander and radishes, as well as different types of spinach, cucumber, okra, eggplant, French beans, amaranth, caperberries, mustard, chilies, watercress, gourds, grains like barley, flax, and millet, and legumes including chickpeas, tur, masoor, and urad dal, or lentils, and fruits including plums, pomegranates, melons, guavas, jackfruit, mulberries, tamarind, and pears. spices and herbs like coriander, verbena, fennel, ginger, and cumin. In his writings, Martin discusses the fruits that the estate sold locally in Kanpur, or slightly further away in Lucknow, which included pomegranates, sweet limes, mulberries, and custard apples from the orchards. They also sold different types of lentils or dal and maize. The fruits were also cultivated for fodder. One quote instructs the help to feed a pomegranate a day to the cranes and the peacocks. And this type of attention to what types of produce animals eat in order to perfume their flesh is also told repeatedly by contemporary cooks and eaters from this region, such as gaming for Siberian cranes who feasted on saffron in their migrations, or feeding saffron pills directly to animals to, again, infuse their flesh. These quotes map onto the drawings, but the drawings also provide far more variety in terms of the produce, as well as insight into the range of products cultivated by the estate than the writings by Martin himself. So alongside fruits, vegetables, grain, and legumes, there were also sweet-smelling flowers, jasmines, poppies, larkspur, trees and shrubs, and numerous medical plants. They also show the limits of Linnaean taxonomy. While some plants bear the classifications like the coriander on the left, others like the radish on the right bear a name so generic that it's hard to discern the specific vegetable. The local names written in Persian and Urdu, on the other hand, are much more specific, such as methi for fenugreek. Through the naming conventions, it becomes clear that different knowledge systems are being woven together and supplementing information that has not yet been provided by the Linnaean system. These drawings were clearly produced to be part of a European classification of natural history, and they map onto the documentation of other colonial officials in terms of their interest in the values of imported and exported goods, especially for, again, export and for revenue collection. So absolutely part of the colonial system. And I just want to briefly mention another company official named James Forbes, who from 1760 to 1784 worked in Western India. And in 1778, he was appointed to be a revenue collector in Gujarat, which included some 200 villages. And like Martin, while he detailed the most high value items in his letters and illustration, like cottons or the chili that you're seeing on the screen, red dyes, tobacco, sugar cane, he also focused on the crops that sustained people. Wheat and other grains like rice or sorghum, millet, beans, dal, and oils for cooking and lights. However, such a series of plants as lucrative colonial goods or those gleaned for sustenance and revenue, they can also be juxtaposed with other depictions of plants, laborers, and poetry to begin to gesture to a wider system. So moving from the ingredients that are documenting what was growing at the time and where those items were moving, to how they were part of an aesthetic system, a part of a series of metaphors. For instance, delphinium. These are actually two more from Forbes's albums, the chana, or the chickpea and jwari, the sorghum. So delphinium, known as nafarman or larkspur, is alone on its sheet of pale paper in Martin's collection, but gains its flower companion, the poppy, in the border of what is now known as the small Clive album at the V&A. Nicholas Roth has discussed how larkspurs and corn poppies, which also feature in Martin's collection of drawings, are both annual flowers that were commonly grown together in mixed or alternating rows, in part because they share similar cultivation needs, but also because they look so attractive together. So they begin to move from, you know, a system of cultivation to one that is aesthetic. The painting on the right was part of an album that contained paintings that are not only unified by the flower friend borders of poppies and larkspurs, but also seem to put the single botanical specimen back within the context of the garden. The album contains alternating pages of specimens, or what we might call flower portraits, with scenes of gardens. So in the painting on the right, we see a man watering the garden while another man hoes it, and a beautiful woman collects its flowery offerings. To give you a broader sense of the album's juxtapositions, we see two paintings of women and children who have collected flowers beneath flourishing trees, followed by a pair of plants on the right, and on the right, the depiction of the only edible plant in the album, the branch of a cherry tree. Following these are two scenes of more masculine activities, a scene of a hunt in the wilderness, and a portrait of a man holding a flower in a garden. These situate the paintings of flowers and fruits within the spaces of cultivation and social activity related to gardens. They also gesture to the labor of cultivation, as we saw in the first painting, where the lady and man hoeing seem to have been added by a later artist to join the man drawing water, as if acknowledging that more people were required in the garden, from those managing it to those experiencing its beauty. The juxtaposition of these works also points to the movement of produce from the garden or farm, which other types of manuscripts depict more explicitly. In the Tashri Yakvam, which translates as the history of the origin and distinguishing marks of the different castes of India, which was commissioned by the company Colonel James Skinner in 1825 from Delhi artists and is now in the British Library, we see paintings of occupations from the garden to the market, or from picked grain and legumes to their roasting and processing, as is seen from fruits distilled into flower waters, oils, and perhaps alcoholic beverages. Another author in this period, Ghulam Yahya, created a compendium of 11 trades for the company official Robert Glynn and Bareilly, again, also in North India, circa 1820. His attention to certain types of labor is also part of the colonial acquisition of information, as are many of the other albums I've discussed, and marks an intersection of cultivation and markets with representation. He includes graham parchers, grocers, and kebab roasters, and detailed price lists, as Meher Afshan Farooqi has discussed. The grocer, for instance, specialized in imported items from the southern Deccan Plateau of India, from the east, the west, and the mountains. And these included nutmeg and cloves, cotton, almonds, ginger, almonds of Kabul, almonds of Dostpur, raisins, currants, and Persian plums, which we see in this schematic table of ingredients and prices. The representation of the grocer with his colorful ware, scales, and pots, and then the graphic rendition solely of the containers. However, a small number of items were grown locally in Bareilly in North India. It is fascinating that in Martin's series of botanical illustrations, none of the foreign items appear, but the artist did visualize most of the local goods, as noted in Ghulam Yahya's list, for instance. So we meet our coriander again, endive, cumin, tobacco, and rose petals in the list and in the illustration. So we start to see that these are really documenting a much more local industry. The manuscript also acknowledges the movement from fields to markets to cook delicacies in the kebab maker. The author distinguishes between recipes made by trained cooks of wealthy people that include cream, ground poppy seeds, ginger juice, and saffron, for example, which are still very familiar as marinating ingredients today. And these ingredients that we know from the grocer were obtained from abroad, versus those available in the market made simply when, and I quote, a cow or goat meat is chopped and red chilies and salt are added. The paste is then stuck on iron skewers and roasted, then sold. And this product could make 150 kebabs, for example. This movement from the fields to markets to foodstuffs is also seen in other illustrated manuscripts from North India, such as the Eid Ki Tahniyat, or Greetings on the Festival of Eid, written by Mir Hassan in 1786, for Nawab Asafuddallah, but this is a manuscript copy from a few decades later. It describes the flourishing city of Faizabad during this festival period, and most resplendently includes market scenes. Here in the whitewashed arched colonnades and on the street, we see vendors selling different types of melons, others selling sherbets and foodstuffs, and hookahs for smoking. Melons, tobacco, rosewater, these items were equally portrayed in Martin's collection of botanical paintings and in Ghulam Yahya's descriptions, as well as in the materials on the other side of produce, in recipes like the kebabs and those described in recipe books. This is a 19th century recipe book, for example. It's lithographed, the Khwan Niyamut, the cuisine of riches or the abundant table, which offers recipes for such comestibles seen in the Ibki Tahniyat manuscript we just saw. Almond sweets like loz badam, scented with roses and saffron, as well as the types of vessels in different materials, such as unfired clay to impart the cool earth and to soak up excess liquid, or copper to retain either heat or cold for serving the recipes discussed inside. Other types of items gain specificity through oral history. Suleiman Khan, the Raja of Mahmudabad, once described to me the first liquid to pass a newborn's lips called gutti. He said that the ingredients depend on the mother and the father's humors and the family's characteristics, and that someone in his family, for example, was never supposed to eat coriander. So the proper herbs were pounded, boiled, liquefied, strained, and given to the child by the Hakim, who is a doctor of Islamic medicine. And I'm showing you one image on the right of a Hakim. And this was the first thing given, he described, even before a mother's milk, in order to purge the child. And this he describes as the very beginning of cuisine. So the single plant splayed on the page in a natural history illustration gains a context outside of the series and the system of classification. Yet it also remains a crucial part of how we might begin to consider these relationships between food and art. So food as an ingredient and art, the representation of it, as well as its sensory experience. Poems also describe cities that were flourishing in terms of a progression of raw foodstuffs. And if anyone ever comes to that Isle of Singhala, writes Malik Muhammad Jayasi in the Hindavi romance Padmavat, circa 1540, as translated by Aditya Bell, it is as if he enters paradise. On every side are planted thick mango groves rising from the earth to meet the sky. Jayasi moves from the mango groves to the fruit, dense and pleasant, to the birds that sit in the mango orchard, to the wells and stepwells, lakes and pools, to the, again, I'm continuing to quote, the ambrosial gardens planted with peerless fruit, watched over carefully, limes fresh in color and orange citrons and almond trees, willows and figs grow there. In fruit are huge citrons, grapefruits and lemons and oranges, red and full of juice. Grapes ripen and apples fresh in leaf. Pomegranates and vines please the eyes. The Indian gooseberries are delightful and the banana clusters hanging low. Mulberries, avaroa, and red currants bear fruit, as do the corinda, jujube, and chironji nut. One can see both sorrel and date and other edible fruits, both sweet and sour. The wells yield water like sherbet, as if mixed with sugar in the channels. It flows through the clay pots of water wheels and soaks the ambrosial vines, end quote. This description is paradisiacal, right? A romantic idealization or a Mughal Arcadia in the phrasing of Sunil Sharma. But it is interesting to read it for the movement from mango groves to cultivated gardens, to flower gardens, to the city and the markets, where all of these items are sold and processed into delicacies and other goods. So why bring all of this together? While this talk has been just a sketch, I wanted to open a conversation on flowers and foodstuffs that are ephemeral, that we can access only through these kind of ingredient lists or these representations, to consider how we might access them holistically from their depiction, from botanical paintings produced for company officials, to albums, poems, narratives, and the cultivators and cooks who tended and transformed them. to some extent, many of these people and plants are absent, right? Plants wilt and die after a few days, or if dried months, dishes go bad, fragrant distillations evaporate. Many of the artists' names I've discussed are now unknown to us, not to mention the laborers depicted as types rather than as individuals. The ephemerality of this material is both within the material itself and in those that tended to it. Is it an appropriate methodology then to build a framework around what is absent through materials that do remain? But artistic production, of course, also has its own goals, which intersect with food and cultivation, but also, of course, aestheticize it. There is a high-low aspect at play here in the histories of these arts. The paintings of plants are often deemed illustrations, sitting somewhere in between science and art in scholarship. Many are part of colonial systems of knowledge acquisition, whereas the late Mughal paintings are within fine manuscripts or albums. And then, of course, we see these same distinctions within histories of food themselves. And we saw that even in the description of the kebabs, right? Those that are made for the masses and those that are made for the elites. So I'll end today's talk on the progression from cultivation to design and society on this double page folio in an album now in the Soane Museum. At the center of the page on the left is the botanical drawing of a mango, surrounded by floral designs set within mango shapes and tones, all within a mango yellow border. And of course, perhaps this is Indian yellow derived from the urine of the cow who eats mango leaves. So again, we return to the source itself. The adjacent folio depicts the youthful Mughal emperor Jahangir holding a mango. And the creator of this album clearly was thinking about how a beloved foodstuff like a mango moves from the fruit itself to pigment, design, and contemplation, both connected to and removed from its life on the tree. So with that, I will end and pass it over to Sussan.
Thank you very much. Holly and I started talking very early on about food as a project many, many years ago, and we can't remember where it was, but these are sort of works in progress, if you will. Now, finally coming, it seems, to closer to a fruition, if I may use that term. thank you for this invitation. Shreya, thank you for your hosting us, and to Emma for making it happen, the practicalities of things. So this too is a project of mine that I've been working on bits and pieces over a long period of time. And this year on sabbatical, I'm hoping to produce a physical something other than the food that I keep making and eating. But before I start, I'd like to ask for your indulgence, as I'd like to make a note of the incredible events that happen in Iran on the streets of Iran and have been spearheaded by brave young women or women of all ages in Iran who have gotten the title of Heroes of the Year from the Times magazine. All of which we forget in the midst of celebrations of Christmas and New Year and this, or wars elsewhere. But that we need to, I feel very strongly as an Iranian who lived through the first revolution, of which this sort of activity, women facing outwards with their arms raised, men facing towards the Ayatollah with their arms raised, that this is a process, a historical process that requires us thinking. And I'm a historian, and I look at these things in terms of the historical location of the movement that becomes that of perhaps emancipation, not just of women, but of the people of a place such as Iran. And in the middle of 19th century, in fact, the origins of this active sort of avant-garde breaking away from the rules of dress for women emerged out of Iran, in fact, with the famous Tahere, the pure one, known as Qurrat al-Ain, the solace of the eye, a poet of enormous significance. And what she did, which was to enter the room at a conference of men without her face cover, which was the norm, caused such uproar that allegedly one of those men cut his own throat and others ran out of the room. In part, this is to say that what is happening in Iran is not a Western-originated feminist activity, but one that has historical roots. And in many of these places, in fact, they happen quite exactly at the same time as they do in the West, in fact. On that note, and I appreciate your kindness in indulging me to bring something that is on the minds of many of us who are deeply affected by what is happening in, and Iran is not just an isolated place, but a representation of a larger territory, if you will. Okay, now I switch to aestheticizing the experience of food. Following what Holly said, I'd like to pick up on, and we can talk about it when we sit down to talk about our respective papers, about that kind of ephemerality of experience of eating food or being in front of food and encountering food, if you will. My project is not about the shared practice, especially of the early modern period. I go a century or so before Holly's project to cover 16th and 17th centuries, and this early modern sort of aestheticizing of food, commensal practices, the emergence of images, picturing food, especially in oil painting in European arts, where the sensuality of food itself comes to life with the use of oil, but also a moment when cookery treatises emerge in large numbers, objects are specifically made for food practices and so forth. So I put it in that context to just say that I'm perfectly alert to the sort of the neighborhoods, if you will, the larger Eurasian context of this early modern period. But I want to focus on the case in Iran, and this is the period of Safavid. It coincides with the Safavid period. There are particularities that emerge out of this, for instance, Shiification of Iran, distinction of an imperial claim that is characterized by Shi'i Islamic approach, which has its own qualities beyond the time I have here. But to note the emergence of a cluster of images and texts, cookery treatises, poetic expressions, objects, and practices that are specifically profoundly important in the production of the of culture, if you will, broadly speaking, in Iran of this period. So I make the project really takes note of these clusters of evidence that are related to food and taste. And this I mean not only in terms of sense of gustatory taste, but also in terms of that's the one that oftentimes dictionaries define it, but also as defined by the ability to judge and recognize what is good or suitable. In the Perso-Arabic context, it would be the term zawq or dhawq, which is in fact context to which I pay a great deal of attention in this project, by looking at the link between painting, texts, and context, as well as, for instance, noting that this album page with the very sensuous sort of a reclining female figure with a dog lapping up liquid out of the bowl, a bunch of flowers, and then the poetic passages around, which reference on the lower right-hand corner of it, for instance, reference fruits, mive, and in fact, connect fruit, food, love together. In a way, edibility, taste, organs of taste and eating come together with notions of beauty and erotic undertones, as it were. So I'm thinking in terms of fluidities in imagination between the real and the ethereal, that which is present and tangible, and that which is evoked and intangible. So again, ephemerality is part of that as well, as it were. But I want to focus my attention here in particular on rice. And rice as the dishes made of rice, and rice as in dishes made for rice, actually. And bring you a few sort of notes on where this goes. In the painting of Jacques Armand's receiving one of the Jacques Armand receiving one of the Uzbek rulers in the murals of the audience hall of the Chehel Sütun Palace. We see a number of activities, amongst which music, dancing, chatting, posing, all of that is part of the deal, but also food, delivery of food, for instance, up here, food displayed all over the place, and dishes that would carry and present the food. In all of these instances, the assumption and literature scholarship has tended to think of them as being imaginary, being sort of evocations of feasts, but never thought of in terms of related to actual practices, or perhaps evocative of events that took place in that same audience hall with these kinds of feasts, which are now sort of conventionally represented. What one finds in these are this correspondence between vast murals, smaller paintings in manuscripts, such as you see on the lower right-hand side, and actual objects, of which the most spectacular display is the dense display at the top of the V&A. Highly recommend a visit there just to look at how amazing it is to look at dishes in stacked up actually in a museum. And there, what I'd like to pose here is, or propose here, is the variety of shapes that we find from, sources as well referenced. So variety of shapes of objects unusual in this period in porcelain and ceramics, in fact, of which I show you a bunch of little dishes and so forth. We hear, for instance, from the order of Chotahmas to host his contemporary emperor of Mughal India, Humayun, where he orders, for instance, in this farman, this directive, how the emperor should be hosted as he took refuge in Iran, with every morning for breakfast, small dishes with certain cheeses or yogurt and sweets and so forth, each of these small dishes to be put in a vast tray and delivered singly. In other words, each companion of the emperor will get one of these trays. And so these dishes that we see, small ones, which we don't know otherwise what they are for, are actually described in terms of what they should deliver for breakfast, for instance, to the emperor, or for courses of meals that were delivered in feasts. Otherwise, in fact, one of the most important things, I point these again to you, is the delivery of, for instance, meals for dinner of various rice dishes, which are mixed with, these are specially made rice dishes, which are supposed to be delivered in vast platters, but not as big as those trays, but platters described to be specific with a certain depth and a certain lip, and that these would be then carried per person of importance. In other words, not shared food out of the same container, but specific ones. And in paintings like the one you see here from the Shahnameh of Shatah Mosque, we find the trays. There is one young man walking out and delivering something which looks like a bejeweled rice, if you will. And I want to point out to this one, which is described in that order for delivery of dinner dishes to Humayun as being a blue and white Chinese platter or porcelain with a lid, a domical lid on top of it. These are part of, in other words, the specifics of what kind of food in what kind of dishes and under what conditions to be delivered and consumed. A sort of a protocol, if you will, of dishes and dishes. And indeed, in these cases, we begin to, the way I'm beginning to see it, is how we patch together bits and pieces that come from an order, a royal farmon, to archival material of the sort that relate to inventories, to the dishes that are sitting for the most part in museums, such as the V&A, to evidence of wall paintings, to evidence of paintings in manuscripts, as well as treatises, cookery treatises, as we come to see them. So here, the specificity of the kind of platter, the langari, as it is called in this order of Shatah Mosque, to be specially used for the delivery of rice, the varieties of sizes and shapes of the objects vis-a-vis the particular delivery mode. And here I refer back again to these dishes with the lid on top. And then these platters for rice, smaller dishes for various kinds of foods, coffee cups, wine cups and wine bottles, which are the variety is enormous in the context of the Safavid material. And then, in addition to those, we have eloquent objects, which are extraordinarily unique in this period, plates and bowls that speak to their own function. And of those, I have gone slightly overboard and have put a number of them on my slides, simply to demonstrate how, for instance, a bowl, the one in the Louvre, would reference drinking out of it, or how a dish will talk about what it is supposed to be delivering and how it is supposed to be experienced. These are unusual for the neighboring environment. In other words, we don't find them in the Ottoman context, we don't find them in the Mughal context, nor do we know of these kinds of dishes, which are eloquent about what their own function is, in the European or East Asian context. It's particularity of the sort of level of correspondence we find in these, in the period of discussion here. And I show you just these two in order to say something about the fact that this is not only about the dishes for food, but also, for instance, a bucket for the bathhouse, which says that it is a bucket meant to pour water over, for instance, the body of the beloved, as the poem on the top bucket indicates. Now, this object eloquence is different from what we know from earlier medieval Islamic material, in which aphorisms and certain fixed phrases were used to speak to the good wishes and the health and prosperity of the owners. Rather, and here is what this object eloquence comes to play an important role in thinking about how food is enlivened and aestheticizes the whole experience, in that we find, for instance, a dish. This is my star example, where the epigraphic band is, in fact, reads or translates as, "When the sun turns yellow in the dark blue sky, I am reminded of saffron rice on a lapis colored dish." And if you put the rice dish into that plate, what you do have, in fact, is this evocation of the poetic, where the sun, the saffron, rises into the blue sky as if that dish of rice within that dish of blue and white is activating that notion, the experience of the saffron rice. More perhaps importantly is the way in which contemporary author chefs talk about the way in which they are bound, duty bound, to colorfully present their dishes and speak to the specifics of how you compose a dish of food and deliver it in a ceramic dish, in a chini, precisely the kind of dish that we find. And finally, and these are all invented recipes, new invented recipes, hundreds of them, which are at this moment really uniquely and only available to the elite, to the rich. They are foods of festivities and the court, but then eventually they trickle down to the larger population and they survive today as the so-called Persian cuisine. If you were to think about Persian food, these rices are the distinguishing features of that. And I point again to the domical lid on top of the dishes as on the right-hand side painting. We hear that all Europeans and Armenians, Syrian and Ottoman travelers to Safavid Persia agree on the uniqueness and excellence, as the words they use, of the rice dishes in Iran. Chardin, the French jeweler traveler who was there in the 1660s, says that Persian style of rice is, quote, "the best esteemed of all Asia." And in fact, my last word, and if I can turn the page, Petros Bedik, a Syrian Armenian visitor who is linked or links between Aleppo in Syria and Esfahan in this period, New Julfa of Esfahan, where the Armenians of Esfahan lived mostly, he writes, and I quote, "The preparation of pilau, this kind of rice, is quite remarkable. In fact, when one lifts the cover of a long plate, its aroma is so sweet that the spirits of all are revived by the admirable power of that food, and each one's appetite, if it was missing, is awakened." It is this kind of a lifting of the lid, sarpush, and that sense of awakening at the sight of the food, at the reading of the poem, if you will. Poems are read out loud with a sort of poetic and musical voice, and that waft of the smell of the food, evoking the taste of the food, those experiences that no longer can be captured except for these kinds of evocations, and the praises that come as part of the sensation of the rice, actually. In other words, this is sensation of rice and the experience of rice that can be brought about by way of composing these pieces of evidence. And that, I argue, and I hope I'm right, but Holly is going to tell me more about it, is an entirely Iranian phenomenon. Thank you.
Would you like me to start, or would you like to start?
It's whatever you prefer.
I mean, they are such different subjects.
Yeah, but there are
overlaps. Yes. So I want to, if I may, I want to start with your last picture, the mango.
Yeah.
Which I think is quite remarkable.
Yeah.
As it really does. If you can talk a little bit more about what you meant, you kind of put it in and moved on. This mango and those oval shaped containers of designs and the color references that go back to mango, actually. If you can speak a little bit more about how you think, I mean, it's one thing you and I look at it. How do you think those were experienced in the time by those who would look at them?
That it's such a wonderful question. And I would need to look more at the manuscript to make sure that those when were those placed together, right? Who was the compiler mm-hmm. of that album? But what does seem very clear, and this is also what I was hoping to ask you about, is this: the compiler seemed to want the viewer to put together the fruit itself, so the food, the ingredient, with all of the things that might come from that fruit, from the taste itself to the potential pigment to the notion of a design in a mango shape, which is so important in textile design, for example, to the contemplation itself of the beauty of the fruit, to its representation in this album. Mm. So they're making that link from the ingredient itself to all of its potentials within the aesthetic realm. And that's, I guess, so it was exciting for me to see that there was that historical recognition, I guess. Mm. Because one thing that I keep thinking about it's so simple, but what is the relationship between food and art? Those are obviously very, and one can approach it from so many directions. And that's what I was hoping to ask you, how you see those in dialogue, I guess, both historically and now, contemporaneously, like what your own interests are in bringing these together.
Yeah. I thank you. You're so clever. Turned it around, Becky. So as soon as you talk about food nowadays, everybody thinks about the star chefs and, oh, it's all gone. We, you know, the science of food is enormous. And I have to say, I find myself completely lost in trying to read about the neuroscience of the senses that relate to food. It's absolutely enormous field and multidisciplinary. And for art historians, it has been, for the most part, it has been more about documenting and more sort of a descriptive approach to food and manners of serving it and eating it and the things that are eaten and what is the narrative that goes around it and so forth. In our fields, they haven't been really explored at all. Ceramics or vessels for food and drink are amongst the most important components of what is called Islamic arts. And yes, all we know about them are the shapes, the types, the technologies, the sizes, and very indexical for the most part. We also get to know, and this is a cup, so it's for drinking, and that is a wine bottle and so forth. But how do they actually function in a context where they're not just stacked up or put together in a book about ceramics and their profiles drawn, but how do they function when you put them into a context of use and then try to evoke them? I wanted to particularly point to that one, the enthronement of Joseph. The story of Joseph is a really important one. The beautiful Yusuf, who is not in this scene, but in its Quranic variation and the Persian poetic variation, is invited into the palace of Zalekha, Potiphar's wife, who is named in the Quran. And Zalekha, in order to prove the beauty of Joseph, which was irresistible for her, she gives every woman in the room a fruit, and the fruit varies according to the depiction of the artist. It could be an apple, an orange, even a cucumber, and a knife. And as Joseph arrives in the room, they all are so taken by his beauty, they all cut their hands of the fruit in hand. So there's this notion of blood dripping, and they don't sense it. And this taste, this notion of a taste of that beauty of Joseph seems to be in these paintings, at least, or the poetic context to come through. But we don't have the language of speaking about those multidisciplinary ways of not just looking and discussing or describing, but also thinking about those experiences that come together with it. So what you were talking, when you were talking about the mango or about those particular fruits, or I mean, you never talked about smell, and I was very interested in hearing about smell. I mean, I think of mango in terms of the taste of mango is contested, right? The Indians think that it's best. Egyptians, I lived in Cairo, Egyptians swear by theirs. There's mango contestation all over the place, but ultimately it's not the taste, it's actually the smell that makes the distinction. So, you know, all your plants have a smell, coriander, you know, all of that. So how do we deal with this? I mean, I came across this thing of lifting the lid and that waft of the smell of the rice. Has anyone eaten Persian rice and knows what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. If you haven't, you wouldn't know what I'm saying. It's that particular smell, and it's dry.
Mm-hmm. And that does come with your question about some of the origins of these foods and the rice dishes are coming from Iran. A lot of those they come to India.
Yeah.
And when you look in the 18th, 19th century with many of those dishes, both in the cookbooks and in the written descriptions, people discuss the final phase of cooking, which is dum, or the breath, where you seal the pot, you then lift it, and the fragrant waters, like the cure, the screw pine flower, the rose water, that's the breath that you get when you lift the lid.
Yeah.
And those are the same plants that are depicted in the natural history illustrations. But you get the scent only when it's in that the cooked phase.
So I wonder,
yeah,
for the East India Company official who commissions these, and this becomes an album and an archive, are those experiences that you're talking about, which are the things that you, are they transferred, or how are they transferred, or have they ever been transferred? In other words, is this transference of that kind of information that is multi-sensory is only available to those who know what is a dampocht?
Right.
I mean, or also the Indie Office library collectors?
It's a great question. I mean, I think that some of the company officials do describe meals, right? And some go into more details than others. They do have a set, I mean, because Martin, as well as Antoine Lupolier, they write in their letters about how they're acquiring. The reason why Martin wants to have so many rose petals is because he wants to distill that, distill the rose water, and he both gives it to people, but it's also for sale, because he knows how important that is as a part of hospitality.
Right.
So he's absolutely aware of that and participating in it. But how do you get to that? What you're just talking about is how do you get to a memory, right? Which is what so kind of precious about eating. Mm-hmm. We all have it on a personal level. There are moments in literature where one encounters it, moments in poetry. And here, like when you were talking with that beautiful connection between the lover and taste, right? There's a phrase in Urdu, the words kababi, sharabi, shababi, right? Mm. So you have your kebab, you have your wine, your sharab, and you have your ladies, right? Or the shababi. And those are linked poetically. And you can, and also onomatopoeia. But, mm. So the sounds themselves lead one to it. One does wonder how much is the food itself, what's within the food, and then the poetic imagination, which it seems like your vessels participate in.
Yeah, that's my argument. Yeah. I don't have, I mean, of, let's say, 100 vessels that have survived, maybe 20 will have epigraphic editions. But it's large enough in numbers to know that this was one category of significance. But we cannot tell which of these dishes were actually used, right? So all you can do is patch together bits and pieces of evidence, and those ephemeral pieces of evidence to intimate some knowledge of what would have been the experience of sitting in a feast and these young men bringing dishes in large numbers to put in front of you. What was it like to be able to read that poem written around that? And these are not shared plates. They are individual, large plates, but individual access to food. So there's something special about that whole thing of, you know, how do you consume the food, you know? And what else goes with it? The sounds and the... I once was taken by two artists to the home of one of them in Esfahan. They ignored me entirely. But they talked to each other, and they were walking around, and they had paintings on the wall, and they would look at it, and one would come up with a poem that was relevant to the subject of the painting. And then they would have a conversation through the poetics of these paintings. We forget that that is part of it. We forget that looking at the paintings trigger a poem in the mind of the viewer. We may not be accustomed to it, but that was the case of experience of those paintings. So that sort of thinking, you know, the manuscript you showed, that wonderful double page of a marketplace with the, was it poems on site or?
It's the narrative.
It's the narrative of what happens.
Yeah.
But are they connects with what is happening?
Yeah, there's, and in fact, there's far more text than our paintings, right? So I just showed one of the double folios, yeah.
So even if you don't know the poem, you can come up with a poem.
Yeah.
In other words,
Yeah, in that case, yeah, there's a narrative that the paintings were
either poems or associated feelings.
But that's one of the things that I think is so hard to access that I think we're both kind of wondering about, right? That is it a single moment? Is it a personal moment that one has in an intimate conversation where you have two artists who are looking at a painting together? That's about them and their connection. Does it become more of a courtly etiquette circumstance? Is it there are these, and is the goal to even access it, or is it
knowing that there is this possibility of
can't obtain that is also attractive?
In other words, our problem more than any of the historical issues.
Yeah.
Amazing. Thank you. I know I have a question, but I'm going to be a good host and look around the room to see if there are other questions as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much to both of you for this both fascinating presentations and the conversation so much enjoyed. I have a question for Sussan. Firstly, I'm not an expert, but this is the first time I hear of anything like that. And I think it's extremely striking, compelling. Your talk, by the way, this inside also made me very hungry, but this is even and I may not be the only one. Can you tell us a little bit more about the group of works with the inscriptions? Mm. They belong to a specific period. What sort of bookends that period? I realize you may not have, you know, answers to all these questions. In which collections are they? Have they been spread all over the world, or are they still primarily in Iran? Do they have other commonalities? Mm. And the question I had is, and I know because of my knowledge of Mughal India that, again, we may not have answers, how much do these dishes with the inscriptions permeate society? Mm. Do they belong only to a sort of ceremonial eating and feasting that we can imagine, you know, depicted at courts, or does it spread a little bit perhaps in commerce and trade societies? I don't know, and again, I realize we may not have the answers, but I wondered if the what qualifies these objects may begin giving some answers to these questions.
Right, it's a really good point. And so when you look at ceramic, it's primarily these dishes, the ceramic pieces that I'm focusing on. The production prior to this period is, for the most part, free of these kinds of writings, the epigraphic, except for those medieval objects, which are filled with aphorisms and so forth. And one of the things that distinguishes them from the 16th, 17th century material is that those are in Arabic and these are in Persian. And this shift to Persian is a really important transition, actually, and then continues. So this is when it starts, but it continues to be produced in 18th century, 19th century, and so forth. But it is specific to the Iranian world and connects, for instance, these vast platters. They are shallow and have a lip, a fairly flat lip. That is only found in the context of Safavid ceramics. Ottoman ceramics tend to be smaller in diameter and deeper. It relates to the kind of food that the Ottoman court, for instance, consumed. So they are specific for rice, it seems, or at least that's how my bits and pieces of information seem to point to. As for are they spread all over the place, most of what is available is actually in European, American collections, Japanese collections, and so forth. The ones that are at the V&A are very instructive because it's a huge number. and the dense display, and they were collected primarily in 19th century from Esfahan and from the houses of Esfahan, which is pointing to a sub-imperial infiltration of this practice. They were heirlooms, essentially, and in huge numbers they were taken. Not in the court. In Iran, those things in the court of the Safavids did not survive as it was raided, unlike the Ottoman court, for instance. So on that level, you know, there are kind of little bits of evidence that make me think that eventually they became more widespread practice, part of the widespread practice. I'm not sure. I mean, the objects are the ones that are in the collections, and I can look. They are the ones that are, in fact, at the V&A are 16th and 17th centuries. How it goes to the let's say the wealthy, not the ordinary household, but the wealthier elite of Esfahan, let's say merchant elite communities, is where they have actually been collected from.
Yes, sir.
That's primarily the evidence.
Right. No, I thought you were saying that therefore they got made in less posh editions.
There are less posh editions too.
They are
I had a question. Actually, so first of all, thank you for two amazing talks and sort of insights into different kinds of things. I was so struck, Holly, by something that you said, and I think this will go to both your talks, but about things that animals were ingesting to flavor their flesh, right? Oh, okay. And I think this idea of the distance between the what we now call farm to table, I suppose, sort of the fields and what is on your plate. And then, and I think, Holly, in your talk, there was one particular example of like agricultural fields, let's say, mm-hmm. gardens, of course, but agricultural fields. And I think in one of yours where it was kind of, you had the table and you had somebody kind of tilling the soil mm-hmm. in the same frame, which I think it's quite interesting. Yeah. And I think I was just curious about first of all, in some sense, what role the senses play as well in between these spaces, because you have this kind of very fragrant, very sort of intense kind of food plate, that kind of nexus happening. And then the agricultural field, the garden is probably quite a fragrant space, but then the agricultural field, like it's sweat and toy, you know, there's a, mm-hmm. it's earthy, there's a difference. And I was curious about whether, and I think, as you were saying, there are limitations to what we can experience through the visual, and so of course we thinking about it in context with text, and so were there texts either in the kind of the text that you're looking at, both of you in both your context, but also whether there were were there letters? Was Claude Martin writing about it? Were other people writing about sort of both agricultural production, because that's such an important part of mm-hmm. sort of revenue, and not just revenue collecting, but also sort of export and things like that. So yeah.
Yeah. No. It's a fantastic question, and it there's things so big, like so economic, right?
Exactly.
Like in fact, the economic histories yield a lot of information about what was being planted, when is it, what are the but then moving to other levels, which is exactly what you're saying, like how do you move from, so if you're looking at older cookbooks, they'll give you names, right? Like a pearl pulao. Mm-hmm. What does a pearl pulao mean exactly, mm-hmm. right?
So then you start to talk to chefs, right? And then
you read a lot of cookbooks, then you look at paintings. And then like one chef I spoke to talked about, you would tie the white of an egg
in
into the silk so that when it cooked with the chicken, you could then unwrap it and those tiny
become the pearls,
right? Like you wouldn't
get there
from the name, right? You have to have this unbelievable imagination. And that's part of the fun. I mean, I think a lot of contemporary chefs play with that a lot, right? Yeah. They'll take a name and then they'll spin, right? Which actually is has a lot of creative potential and should be lauded. But there are these gaps, right? Between the historical record and then where you move to something else. And that's where I think some of the knowledge of kind of knowing, and this was again, just, this was an, just a cook who realized that the Siberian crane that people were talking about in the recipe books traveled over the Kashmir, the saffron fields in Kashmir, right? So then that's how they're ingested. And then that suddenly changes how you think about the recipe. And so there's just an ingenuity of cooks and ingredients and bringing that all together. And you do see that. And the connection, exactly, and the seasonality. And there's just a real beauty to that. And but I think it is this kind of cobbling. And that's why when I was first doing this research, where I was trained as an art historian, but I wasn't necessarily doing art historical research, you start to think, well, actually, is art history actually a wonderful methodology for approaching ephemeral arts? Because sometimes what you're dealing with is absent. When you look at the ceramics, ceramics are made to hold food, but we almost never talk about the food. That's the thing that's missing. But yet, that's why I'm so curious, and I'm curious for everyone in the audience, actually, like, is art history, does it actually provide the tools to come at some of this ephemerality?
I mean, just to say to you, all the audiences online here as well, I think these are hopefully the questions, kinds of questions we're going to talk about through the different talks as well. So I think hopefully it'll be an ongoing conversation with all of you as well.
Could I add one thing to what Holly just said about if art history is the proper tool for that? I actually think it is, but I think it is art history as practice with regards to fields that are not of the origins of art history as a discipline. In other words, the discipline is changing because people who look at different representations and expressions through art, spatial or material, have different problems to deal with, like the ones that we face. So perhaps it's time for our history to think that it's a discipline, its doors are open, that it is with these other, you know, those who practice things around African art history are teaching us things we never thought of, for instance. That's at least pondering whether it's the right tool.
Just on the topic of we think of ceramic food, we have a comment from Sabrina Brown online saying thank you to you and Nadine for helping me visualize how the saffron rice would have looked on a lapis colored dish. But we do have a couple of other questions from online, so I think I'm just going to read I can do both and then maybe you can answer them quite specific. So Sujata Migama asks, when are local names of plants and languages beyond English first used in botanical drawings in India? Difficult question. And what might be, what might the presence of these multiple languages reveal to us? And also, how wonderful did the text on the diverse vessels relate to the food or drink served in them? How can we access the food cultures of those not so privileged through these diverse vessels we've talked about a little bit already? I'll just go on to the next question so we can answer them together. Giorgia Mafioli Brigatti asks a question about the cultivation of flowers. Could they also be planted next to one another depending on the combined perfume they would create, which is actually a really interesting point. And she also has a question for Professor Babaie. It was common to chew cloves when talking to the Shah or in gatherings. Would it be possible to trace if specific spices were chewed before eating so as to highlight the taste of the food itself? Such great questions. Thank you, online audience.
I know all three of them.
Go for it.
Do you want to talk about, for instance, the Eshod of Zera, this treatise on agriculture, which has a chapter on, I mean, a treatise on agriculture with a chapter on gardening. And I think we might have to go back and look at that one freshly. It was written early in the 16th century, probably gathering knowledge of the 15th century Timurid for the benefit of the emerging Mughals in South Asia primarily. But it's a really important documentation. And there you see, for instance, in the gardening thing, how to plant what flowers, what bushes, because of their fragrance and seasonality and so forth. So can you think of those in the Indian context further than, you know?
Absolutely, and they're such wonderful, wonderful garden historians.
Yeah.
Just thinking of, I mentioned Nicholas Roth, who's and Ebba Koch has, I think, right. And she's had, because among scholars, in replanting, so replacing the colonial lawn with the orchards and the flowers, that the orchards would be around her bed. And also have bees and certain birds come at certain times, so then you'd have the sound of certain birds. And that was very, very much, that seems to be part of the garden. And I imagine
I think that's the point is really, it's partly about the gardens and the fragrances, but also the fruits and vegetables and what you can actually extract from there, the herbs, you know, the medieval gardens of the monasteries, like the one in the Metz cloisters up on top of the Manhattan Island is a really great example of the kinds of gardens that we know from medieval world in Europe, but it is also crucially important to consider. We never hear about kitchen gardens that I know of, but there must be an aspect of the kitchen garden in those kinds of garden designs as well. But I was also thinking about objects that are particularly made for encapsulating, protecting smell of things like rose water. You know, these glass things for rose water, which is to prevent it from evaporating for as long as possible. Sujata's question, my dear colleague, which you might want to think about, her question about, was it about the dishes and if those kinds of eloquent dishes appear in a more pedestrian version. No, or if they did, they haven't survived. Survivals of these are usually related, especially of earlier periods, related to the elites.
What's interesting with the rice, like with the rice dishes you're speaking about when they're coming to India, at least in the histories that I've read of the cuisine of baking rice, so the pulao or what also becomes a biryani in India, that those were come in these huge pots, right, that were brought in order to feed huge numbers of people. And in Lucknow, at least, you still see them feeding huge numbers of people. So like in Lucknow, and this is part, you know, it can sometimes be hard to parse what is lore and what is But the Nawab Asif Udawla, there's a time of great famine, and right. and some of the famine architecture at this time is really interesting. The Nawab obviously built huge buildings, and the pots to create rice would have them cooking outside of religious structures
right.
connected to Shiism.
Yeah,
and you still see that today during those times of year. But then you also have kind of huge granaries that company officials and that they're also erecting, sometimes to be filled, sometimes not to be filled. So this the idea that you would also have to counter famine is something that one
really
must think about as well. And you do see, that's what I've found so interesting in some of the compilations of natural history illustrations, that you have some of these very elite goods, very lucrative goods, like rose water. Mm. But then you also have just your basic grains that are so critical. And I think some of those dishes, they're made for the populace. They're mm-hmm. not necessarily made for the elites. And so it's just so interesting to, but they can be just, they can be as, like I always think about making yogurt, right? Where you're making yogurt in clay vessels because the clay absorbs that extra whey and thickens the yogurt. So it makes it more delicious. So they're like the vessel and the thing inside of it are tied together.
Yeah. By the way, that just on the level of feeding the larger population, the Ottoman court had kitchens that were also producing for food given away to the populace, as did Safavid court, and I imagine Mughal court. So none of them made the food only for the consumption of the court and its festivities, but also to be shared as a form of barakat, you know, that kind of generosity and an obligation, actually. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and just before we close, just going back to the clove question and the language question of where, when did the languages in the botanical paintings come in, if, or even what they signify, I suppose, and what relevance it has for scholars today or also then?
It's such a wonderful question. Yeah. I mean, in some ways they work as like a Rosetta Stone, I think, to a certain, where you'll have the different names. But sometimes you'll have a Linnaean name that's just like the very, very generic, like vegetable, you know, like it's a very generic name. And then the other languages are much more specific and it's, and they can be in different hands as well, which are showing kind of the different knowledges that are entering into the image. And that's why the inscription, how the artist is, what the artist depicts and what is inscribed can offer different types of knowledge. Yeah. And I think that's what I've at least, and again, this is with thanks to Henry Nolte, what's been so interesting in looking at just the kind of data set of the natural history drawing, that they're being gathered for the scientific purpose.
Exactly.
But they can actually offer, if you look at them aslant, they can offer other types of knowledge and connection to the land and to cultivation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It also kind of exposes a sort of native informant work that that's being created and cultivated as well.
Was it Georgia who asked about clove, right? Before you eat
No, cloves before you meet the Shah. And so were there other things that you would chew before you eat to enhance the taste of food?
Not that I know. The courses of meat, they come in from this Safavid period, what we understand already. They come in courses. And when the courses start actually with what Europeans all talked about as being dessert, what are they doing? They serve the dessert first. And they did, and Iranians still eat the dessert first. So to get the appetite going, you start with fruits and sweets, actually. Mm. But to have something in particular, it's you have to look a little bit more in closer to get that information, which I haven't.
Um, we should have thought ahead and planned for, you know, sort of baked rice and saffron, but we don't have that. So, apologies, but we do have wine in the next room. So I think we'd say a big thank you and then carry on our conversations. Thank you.